Dan Glover suffers from epilepsy. Rejected by society, he is returning on his own to the one place he feels secure. Months ago, Dan had been discharged from this hospital with his seizures fully controlled, his treatment successful. Let's go back and find out what had gone wrong. Home for Dan Glover once meant a small New England town. The Glover home looked like all the others on the street. Dan's childhood had been no different from most children, with the exception of what his mother called his blackout spells. These petit mal seizures, or minor attacks, lasted from 5 to 30 seconds, with a transient loss or impairment of consciousness. Immobility, rhythmic twitching of the eyelids, or nodding of the head are the most frequent signs of petit mal. Rare in adults, such attacks are common in children, recurring from several to many times each day, but tending to diminish with increasing age. In Dan's case, his parents did not regard these spells too seriously. By the time he'd reached his senior year in high school, they had disappeared. After high school, Dan worked in a local garage where he could put to use his aptitude for anything mechanical. He also began to go steady with a childhood friend, Dora Reed. When the new state highway came through town, the garage expanded, and Dan, at last realizing his ambition to become a mechanic, felt prepared for new responsibilities. Inducted into the armed forces, Glover failed to include his blackouts in his history of childhood illnesses, for he felt they were of little importance. A week or so after going overseas, Dan learned he had become the father of a boy. Home again, Dan was made head mechanic. His fellow workers noted he had aged considerably, for good reason. The head injury he suffered during the war had increased his susceptibility to seizures. His resistance was so lowered that now he had actual convulsions, however, only during his sleep. Dan went to his family doctor, but the medicine provided him for these nocturnal convulsions gave little relief. Then one day, what Dan had lived in deadly fear of for the past few years happened. First, he became aware of a strange sound. In his case, an auditory aura signaling the onset of the seizure.
Gave us a scare. You better go on home now, Dan. Take all the time off you want. Don't come back until you've had a darn good checkup.
I'm okay. I'm all right.
No, Dan. I can't have you working around cars in your condition. I can't afford to have customers see such things. Now, you listen to me. Go on home.
I'll be all right.
Dan never did go back. Instead, never owning up to his seizures, he went from job to job. As word of his condition spread, he sank lower and lower in the occupational scale. The day he was discharged from his last job, Dora brought the problem out into the open. Together with the family doctor, she entreated him to abandon his hopeless turning from job to job. Instead, seek admission to a Veterans Administration hospital. At the hospital, Dr. Willard, the chief resident neurologist, was assigned Glover's case. In examination of a case of suspected epilepsy, there is no more important aspect than the history of the patient's past. Dan was asked for a detailed account of his seizures, their frequency and severity. Any precipitating factors such as alcohol, fatigue, excitement, hunger? Did he have any localizing or after symptoms? What was his previous medication? Did he have a normal delivery? Any head injury after birth? Any childhood diseases? Had he suffered from enuresis, sleepwalking, or dreamy periods? Any seizures or related conditions among members of his family? Glover was then given a complete examination, including a thorough physical and a neurological examination. Various diagnostic procedures were used to determine whether Glover's seizures were due to brain damage resulting from injury, tumor, or disease, and if such existed, where in the brain was the damage located? A blood test was made to rule out contributing conditions, such as hypoglycemia or syphilis. A spinal puncture was performed for pressure readings and chemical analysis. After routine chest x-rays, Glover's skull was x-rayed to detect pineal shift, bone irregularities, or presence of abnormal calcification. In a psychologist's office, among other evaluations, Glover was given a Rorschach test to help provide data about his total personality. Within a few days, Dan came to know the men in the ward. They were a friendly group, insulated in their hospital world against external pressures and prejudices. Men of different types, different ages, and intelligence. Variations such as you would find in any group in the outside world. Yet, in spite of their apparent normalcy, they were different. What was the mark that set them apart? The electroencephalograph provided one answer. Electrodes attached to the patient's scalp pick up the electrical pulsations of the brain and transmit them to the electroencephalograph, an instrument that amplifies the voltage several million times, and then records them on the electroencephalogram, or the EEG. In normal individuals, these tracings, or brain waves as they are called, have a characteristic rhythm, frequency, and amplitude. But in epilepsy, even in the absence of a clinical seizure, the brain waves of the patient tend to lose their normal rhythm and to be interrupted by bursts of abnormal waves called seizure discharges. Epilepsy, therefore, is a cerebral dysrhythmia. In Glover's case, routine EEGs were performed. Since his waking record was normal, certain activating agents were used. First, hyperventilation. For overbreathing draws carbon dioxide from the lungs and blood, thus making the brain more alkaline and more susceptible to seizure discharges. Glover's EEG showed a considerable buildup, consistent with, but not diagnostic of, epilepsy. Next, secanol-induced sleep, because sleep often uncovers seizure discharges. Finally, a modified Gusteau technique, a slow injection of metrazole given simultaneously with photic stimulation. With the injection of 1 cc together with photic stimulation, the record was normal, with some muscle activity present. When 3 cc's of metrazole had been injected, the record began to show some slow activity and increased amplitude. Finally, when 4.5 cc's were injected, a seizure-like discharge was observed. Even though further injection of metrazole was stopped, additional seizure-like discharges continued to appear on the record without causing the patient to have a clinical seizure. A social service worker interviewed Dan shortly after his arrival in the epilepsy ward. She explored his employment background. She also received his permission to interview his wife and parents about his seizures and family history. To help Dan understand the nature of epilepsy, she gave him several pamphlets. Several days later, Dan, for the first time, saw a grand mal seizure similar to his own. A loss of consciousness, a powerful muscular spasm and rigidity characteristic of the tonic stage. Then the clonic stage, abrupt and strong jerks, convulsing parts of the body in a series of violent shocks. Eventually ending with relaxation of muscular activity and return of respiration. Finally, consciousness returned, though the patient was confused and disoriented.
The name epilepsy comes from the Greek word, meaning seizure, or to be seized. As you may know, the nerve cells of the brain give off electrical beats, or discharges. Now, usually, these beats are given off in a certain rhythm. In epilepsy, however, the electrical activity of the brain loses this rhythmic character, and in a seizure takes on the pattern of an electrical storm. Now, we have two types of epilepsy, the acquired and the genetic. The acquired type indicates brain damage from external causes, from such things as tumors, disease, or injury, either at birth or later in life. The genetic type indicates a predisposition or an inherent tendency to seizures. But in recent years, more and more cases once thought to be genetic now are turning out to be of the acquired type. I think we can illustrate the causes of epilepsy more clearly if we use our imagination. Suppose we consider the causes as water impounded in a reservoir. The dam or barrier holding back the impounded water we'll call the seizure threshold. When the water level overflows this dam, a seizure results. Now, the water level resulting from the individual's predisposition is fixed. It was present when he was born. Of course, the higher the water level in the individual, the greater his chance for an overflow, a seizure. Conversely, the lower the water level, the greater his chance for no overflow, no seizure. Let's take this comparison a step further. More water may flow into the reservoir. The water level, of course, rises. For example, brain damage. Other contributing causes are bodily disorders, emotional tension, or both. In fact, seizures in an individual are very often caused by a combination of these factors. So, to cut down the frequency of this periodic overflow, our job is to raise the level of the dam, or the restraining bank. For example, in the case of brain damage, by anti-seizure medicine, or surgery if indicated. In the case of certain bodily disorders interfering with the nutrition of nerve cells, by different types of medical therapy aimed at improving nutrition of nerve cells or controlling seizures. In the case of emotional tension, by emotional adjustment. To get back to anti-seizure medicines, for 50 years, one type of medicine, bromides, was used on the assumption that a sedative was indicated for epilepsy. Then it was discovered that a medicine with a different chemical base, phenobarbital, was often more successful than bromides. Still more effective is dilantin, first introduced in 1938. Later followed by mesantoin. Another new medicine, tridione, particularly effective in petit mal cases. Today, many new medicines are being developed and evaluated. But you must remember that some medicines, though effective for some types of epilepsy, are harmful to others. That's why, in each of your cases, treatment has to be individualized. Because just as every one of you as a person is different, so is your type of seizure.
Though Dan still rebelled against the thought of his having epilepsy, in time he came to know the different types of seizures. Jacksonian, starting at one point and spreading in a march, either motor or sensory, with consciousness usually retained. Psychomotor, characterized by confusion, more or less automatic movements, followed by amnesia. A focal seizure turning into grand mal. He saw the proper steps taken during a seizure, the gag to prevent biting the tongue, turning the head to one side to avoid aspiration of saliva and to prevent the tongue from dropping back into the throat. The next week, because of the history of Glover's injury, a pneumoencephalogram was performed under sedation. After the initial procedure, which is the same as for a spinal puncture, the spinal fluid is allowed to flow out in small amounts and is gradually replaced by oxygen or air, which rises to fill the ventricles, cisterns, and sulci of the brain. Due to the difference in density between the air and the surrounding brain tissue, a contrast medium is provided which may show distortions of the ventricular passages, cisterns, or sulci on X-ray film. Views of Dan's head were taken from different positions. At the weekly staff conference, among other cases, Glover's was discussed.
Dr. Willard, will you present your case, please?
Glover is a 29-year-old man with a history of brief episodes of petit mal in childhood. He had no grand mal seizures until 1 month after a non-penetrating head injury with loss of consciousness during his army service. There are no focal features. Neurological examination was negative.
Dr. Willard demonstrated that there was no evidence of a space-occupying lesion, atrophy, or scar. Glover's was a normal pneumo. As the days passed, Dan kept busy. He had learned that with productivity, the expenditure of energy, lactic acid and carbonic acid are produced in the brain and muscles, which tends to prevent seizures. Dan by now had become fast friends with the patient, Russell. He knew that Russell's seizures were caused by an injury from a shell fragment, producing a brain scar. Since the cause of Russell's seizures had been discovered, and since preoperative trials with medicines had failed, surgery was being considered. In World War II, about 20,000 of our servicemen suffered penetrating wounds of the brain. About 1 in 3 of these men have or will have seizures. The day came for Russell to be moved to the neurosurgical ward. On the morning of Russell's operation, Dan was in the corridor, waiting. Within the operating room, preparations were made for the operation. With the patient under local anesthesia, the scalp was incised. After a trapdoor had been made in the skull, the bone flap was turned back. The dura was then incised, and the surface of the brain exposed. Here was the scar, the source of Russell's trouble. Originally localized by the EEG, using scalp electrodes. But now, in order to find the maximum point of discharge, a set of cortical electrodes was attached to the skull. Each electrode then was carefully placed on the surface of the brain in order to record directly the electrical pulsations from different regions of the brain. The pulsations coming from the region of the scar were transmitted to the electroencephalogram. To make these tracings easily visible to members of the operating team, they were simultaneously projected on a screen. Immediately, spontaneous spike discharges appeared from the margin of the scar. An electric stimulator was then applied to a region away from the scar. The record remained within normal limits. The stimulator was then applied to the area where spike discharges had been previously observed. Now, continuous spike discharges from this area appeared for a period lasting 3 minutes. Therefore, the gyrus from which the spiky activity was obtained was presumed to be the epileptic focus. This, then, was the area to be excised. After the area of abnormal discharge had been removed, and after the electrodes had been placed around the rim of the excision, further tests were made to see if any additional areas of abnormal discharge remained. A spontaneous record without stimulation revealed no spike discharges. Stimulation was then applied, but no spike discharges were obtained. Even with repeated stimulation, the record remained normal, suggesting that all irritating tissue had been removed.
Dr. Willard,
how's Russell?
He's all right.
Hey, Doc, why won't they operate on me?
Come here, Dan. Sit down. Let me try to explain something, okay?
Sure.
Russell has a deep wound that injured the right side of his brain. It caused a scar. I remember before his injury, he had no tendency toward seizures. After the injury, the brain cells irritated by the scar produced the seizures. You yourself have probably noticed that Russell's seizures were confined mostly to the left side of his body. But through his neurological examination and his EEG, we knew roughly the location of the irritated nerve cells, or what we call the discharging focus. But since we couldn't control Russell's seizures by medicine and doses that he could take, we had to remove the scar. In your case, Dan, we have no evidence that points to any particular area of your brain causing your seizures. And another thing, surgery doesn't always mean a cure. Chances are Russell may still have to take medicine, or he may still have seizures. Does that answer your question?
Kind of insanity. He ought to be put away.
Too bad. It passes on from the parents to the kids.
I can't understand how his wife takes it. She's really a wonderful woman, the way she stood by.
When Dan was put on medication for the first time, he refused the capsule. He was summoned to Dr. Willard's office, where Dr. Willard reminded Dan that his wife was patiently awaiting the day examinations would be completed and his treatment established.
No, Doc, a guy can't live that way, taking medicine like dope. Afraid every minute it's gonna happen. If I can't get it out of my system, then I'm no good for her or for anyone else.
Look, Dan, these medicines aren't habit forming. Remember, Dan, others besides you have had epilepsy. Pretty big men in history. Men like Socrates, Caesar, Mohammed, Alexander the Great, Lord Byron.
Dr. Willard explained to Dan that although it is true the old fears and superstitions, barriers erected in the dark ages around the person suffering from epilepsy have not been broken. Nevertheless, the fog of misinformation surrounding the disorder is gradually being penetrated. Today, there are about 50,000 veterans suffering from epilepsy. In our entire population, nearly 1 million victims, most of whom, if given the opportunity, could lead normal lives. For today, through medication, the seizures of most epileptic patients can be controlled. If not entirely eliminated, their frequency cut down. Establishing the proper medication for the individual patient, however, often takes weeks. Sometimes months. Dan was started on 4 capsules of Dilantin daily. Meanwhile, through a series of aptitude tests, Glover's vocational abilities have been assessed with relation to his employment history and his potential for the future. After a series of talks with a vocational guidance advisor, since he would no longer work around automobiles and was unwilling to appear before the public, Dan finally selected auto parts clerk for his future occupation. Throughout her husband's hospital stay, Dora Glover visited him at every opportunity. In fact, her unflagging faith in his eventual return to a normal life with his family was Dan's main support. By now, Glover's dosage had been increased to 6 capsules a day. In a 10-day period, no seizures were noted, but symptoms of toxicity appeared, staggering, dizziness. When Dilantin was decreased to 5 capsules and some phenobarbital added, these toxic symptoms disappeared.
Dr.
Preparing for the day of his discharge, Dan studied typing and bookkeeping to help him get started on his new occupation. Occasionally, within the epilepsy ward, bull sessions help the patients talk things out, get frustrations off their chests. As usual, employment was the subject uppermost in their minds.
If you had a job, everything'd be fine.
That's right. If I had a job, when I have a job outside, it's better, it's a lot better for me. I feel better. I went, I think it was about two or three months without seizures. I was working outside all the time. Just labor, that's all it was, just plain hard labor. And I liked it. It was outside. And then I got a seizure, and here's your pay. We don't need you anymore.
The men felt keenly the discriminations practiced against them.
For one thing, I've been picked up three times by the police department and brought in. And the first time they thought I was, said I was drunk.
I've been going to school for a year, and then these seizures have been, well, rather hard on me, and I haven't been able to concentrate on my studies. And now that, I'm going to school under the GI Bill, and I feel that now, after I've been kicked out of school, that they won't let me back in because of the seizures. Well, I think that if the public knew a little bit more about it, I think that we would be better off. I mean, we could still keep on going to school. They wouldn't, they'd give you a, well, they'd,
give you a break, huh?
Give you a break, sort of.
Dr. Willard, now that I've got my seizures under control, what are my chances of getting the right kind of a job?
Well,
but the only way you can get a job is just go get one and just conceal the fact that you are an epileptic.
You might as well get down to brass tacks. Is almost 98% of them, when they find out, or if you tell them you have epilepsy, they tell you, we don't want you, we'll get somebody else. I mean, they don't tell you in that words. They got a million ways of brushing you off. They give you reasons, but they got it. It sounds like they got them planned.
Time and again, the discussion veered back to what occupied them most. Is there somewhere a job for me?
Well, no, but it was the only kind of job it was the only job that I knew that was open. So I took it. I didn't tell them anything about it.
Well, now, when you go out for a job, you should tell them that you have epilepsy. Tell the truth about it.
Dr. Willard, if you needed a job bad, would you tell them that you were an epileptic?
Would you do it?
Well, that's a question. You men have probably come up against a lot of other misconceptions about epilepsy. For example, heredity. Will epilepsy appear in your children? The answer is probably not. For epilepsy itself is not inherited, only the tendency. And that tendency may be hidden for generations. In any case, the odds are about 40 to 1 that your child will not develop seizures. And then there's the old saw about mental deterioration usually accompanying epilepsy. Well, that, of course, is not true. You need only to consult your history to know that. Some of our brainiest men were victims of epilepsy. And incidentally, as you grow older, instead of your seizures growing worse, the fact is they will tend to diminish in intensity and frequency. But it is true that in many cases in the outside world, epilepsy still remains in the darkness of prejudice and ignorance. It's up to all of us, you men and us doctors, to be the missionaries of the truth about this disease. How can you help? By looking upon your affliction realistically, not by trying to conceal your seizures, but honestly admitting them when looking for a job. Frankness about epilepsy will go a long way to create a new and intelligent attitude.
And so the day came for Dan to be discharged from the hospital. A combination of Dilantin and Mazantine had been established as his most effective medication, and his seizures under ordinary conditions of life stress were controlled. Dan was reminded that he must take his medicine, like his food, every day. That once a month he was to report to the epilepsy clinic or to his doctor. Home again, Dan was aware of the curious stares of bystanders. But fortified by his hospital experience, he didn't mind. For a few days, he was content in being reunited with his family. But soon the drive for work, for a job, sent him back to the garage. He was welcomed warmly, but the subject of a job was evaded until...
Hey, Lou, how about that job of auto parts clerk?
Gosh, I'd like to, Dan, honestly.
I've got my seizures under control. I haven't had any now in a...
No, Dan. No, I can't. The insurance people say an accident on the job and compensation payments would raise our insurance premiums sky high.
But, Lou, I thought that...
Why don't you take it easy for a while? Until you're really all well.
How long?
Well, give yourself a year.
Dan canvassed the town. People vowed their interest in his welfare, but everywhere the dread word epilepsy had preceded him. Everywhere the answer was the same. In time, as his emotional strain grew, Dan's spirit began to break. Dora saw him sinking back into his old shell. She urged him to break loose from their hometown, look elsewhere for a job, where the old superstitions, the age-old fears about epilepsy might not exist. In a new world among people he had never known, Dan felt he might get the break he so badly needed.
Well, we'll put this through for you right away.
Oh, by the way, I used to have epileptic seizures. I'm over all that now.
Gee, I'm sorry, fella, but...
Well, thanks anyway.
Dan knew to be less liable to seizures, he must be productive, engage in physical or mental activity. Yet wherever he went, he was met by an insurmountable barrier of words. Workman's compensation, accident insurance. No voice answered that when placed in the proper type of job, away from moving machinery, from working heights, from jobs entailing responsibility for the lives of others, studies have proven that those with epilepsy have no higher accident rate than any other group. When Dan's medicine ran out, he lacked the initiative to find out where in the city he could have it replenished.
Mister, I've got to have a job. I've got a family. For sure, I've been an epileptic, but does that make me a monster? Give me a break, will you?
Finally, by concealing his history of epilepsy, he was able to get a job. Only until he had a seizure. So, concealing his illness, Dan went from job to job. And so again, Dan found himself on the road, It was a great, busy world where everyone seemed to have a sense of direction. But he was lost. Again and again, once settled, his footing had been pulled from under him. Was there any hope, any means of finding his way ever out of the senseless maze that was now his life? That was when Dan, in search of assistance, returned to the hospital. That was what had happened. For Dr. Willard, Glover's problem was by no means new. Time and again, social rejection had broken down all the good accomplished by the hospital. Aware of Dan's state of mind, Dr. Willard must start all over again with a calm approach.
Well, Glover, how are things going?
I can't take it anymore, Dr. Willard. It's not got me licked.
Why not tell me about it?
First, he must bring the patient out of his deep despair and instill within him an anchor of hope. The job was not easy. Dr. Willard began by telling Dan of the National Epilepsy League, a nationwide organization of lay people and doctors formed to bring information about epilepsy to the public. He also reminded Dan that research was going on every day. Research in neurological centers, which in the past 2 decades has led to the development of effective anti-seizure medicines, helped produce the electroencephalograph, research that may eventually reveal all the causes of epilepsy. Then exhibits in hospitals and clinics throughout the country. Lectures by VA neurologists.
But remember, purely scientific advances alone cannot solve the problem of epilepsy among veterans. The question of social readjustment still remains an essential part of total medical care.
Yes, today VA physicians and professional personnel must realize the importance of this concept of total care for epilepsy, the need for a vigorous program outside as well as within the hospital. Dr. Willard had Glover spend that night in the ward. From his own experience, Dan now knew what set these men apart. In the long expanse of their lives, momentary spells, perhaps a few moments each week, each month, each year, yet sufficient to set them apart from their brethren. For even though seizures may be controlled, the stigma of the word epilepsy remains. But Dr. Willard had given Dan hope that someday the veteran suffering from epilepsy might no longer have to walk with the dark, secret fear in his eyes. That someday epilepsy might be accepted for what it is, a momentary disturbance of the electrical circuits of the brain. And when that day came, men like Glover would walk with their heads high, at one with their fellow men, at last functioning members of society, of the community in which they live.